science enthusiasts and pet enthusiasts, welcome to Science Chat. Every week we bring you an amazing expert to talk about their area of knowledge. Today we have a combo of science and dogs with our expert guest, Dr. Mallikarjun. Dr. M, the good doc, was on the podcast 2 years ago as a guest, a while ago, and you're so gracious to come back. My name is Jason Zukowski. I'm the host. My co-host behind the scenes is my wife, Chris. And we are quadcasting from Twitter Spaces to LinkedIn Audio, Clubhouse, and also Wisdom. So welcome to everybody who's listening on all the different platforms. But special welcome to Dr. Mallikarjun. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Glad to be here.
Yay! I re-listened to part of our interview and I had so much fun talking to you about what you study, because we'll get into a little bit of it. You started one way with your career and then just went a completely different path after that. And now you're into some exciting stuff with dogs. Could you tell
everybody? It took a very hard left turn.
Could you tell everybody a little bit about like where you are in the world? You don't have to give us your exact address, but just like geographically, where are you calling into from?
Sure. I'm from Philly originally, and I'm also there now working at UPenn.
Okay. Would you say you were born and raised in Philadelphia?
I would. Not in West Philly, but actually further west than that. So
I wonder if anybody got that reference. I got the reference, so I thought it was great.
It's great. It's a mandatory Philadelphia reference.
I introduced you as you have a doctorate. Could you explain a little bit about your education? Like what got you started in science? What science training do you have?
Sure. I actually started I'll start in my college, because I went into college saying I'm going to study bilingual learning, because I grew up bilingual and I was really fascinated with the process of learning two languages at once. And especially because I ended up being a heritage speaker, which is when you speak your home language. So English for me, because I grew up here, I speak it a lot better than I speak Tamil, which is my native language. So I can only kind of understand fluently and then say a couple of things that a three-year-old would say, like, give me yogurt, which is not particularly useful for me right now. So I was really interested in how that works. That process works. So I studied in an infant learning lab in college. And then I wanted to get a PhD studying second language acquisition and infant speech perception and language learning. So I headed over to the University of Maryland, where I studied with Dr. Rochelle Newman, who is a wonderful professor who studies speech perception and noise primarily. So how children are able to learn words when there's a lot of noisy environment in the background, like if you live near a train station or you live near a lot of traffic. So I was doing work with her looking at bilingual speech perception and noise, mostly in adults. And about halfway through my PhD, I was kind of having second thoughts about my research. You know, like I was like, is this really the path I want to take? And bilinguals are a really, really hard group to study because of how different they are. So, you know, you get one result when you look at this group of bilinguals, you get a different result when you look at another group. So I was unsure if I wanted to keep continuing. And then we had a lab meeting about speech perception in animals and studying speech perception across species. And I said, wouldn't it be great if we ran a speech perception and noise study on a dog? And I meant it as a joke.
fully
as a joke. I just said, like, huh, wouldn't that be funny? We also suggested like goats and pigs and other various things. But then I really thought about it and said, you know what? Actually, dogs are a great species to study language learning cross-linguistically because of how interested they are in humans and human speech. So we ran the study. It went really, really well. The dogs behaved just like the infants in the methodology, and that led to a whole field of research for me, and that's how I kind of ended up in that field. And then for my postdoc, I sort of jumped sensory systems, so I went from speech perception to olfaction. So I always joke that I'm trying to be like the avatar of the senses, you know, like eventually I'll do seeing and you know, like the other ones. But right now I'm doing olfactory perception, so scent detection work.
Right. Okay, so we're going to get to that. Do you think once you get past all of that, you'll get to some kind of sixth sense that some people think dogs have?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. It'll be, when your dog or your cat just kind of stare into space, you know, we'll look to see if they're looking at ghosts.
That's the creepiest thing. If I ever find out that Bunsen or Beaker, when they're barking at nothing, it's because there's dead people there. I don't know if I'll ever go outside again. So I'm sorry if I missed it, Doc. You said that you are bilingual yourself. Did you mention which two languages you speak? I'm sorry if you said that.
Oh, no worries. It's English and Tamil, which is a South Indian language.
Okay.
The Tamil is it's rough. I can watch movies and understand fluently, but I can't say very much, and it's with a very bad accent.
That's kind of like me in French, hey Chris?
Yes, absolutely.
Où est la bibliothèque, ma chérie?
Yeah, exactly.
Dans la ville.
Oh, c'est dommage, ma petite bijou. That's the line I say to kids. I teach at a bilingual school, French and English, in Alberta, Canada. So I had the Be French. Yeah, Chris does too.
It means jewel.
Yeah, that's too bad, my little diamond. Rough translation. Okay, back to the show. I sometimes get off topic. When you were younger, were you interested in science, or were you more interested in language? Like you went into wanting to study multi-language learners, but the whole aspect of study is curiosity. Were you a curious person when you were young?
I was intensely curious.
Oh, man.
My family really drove that. So first, I was a kid with a big old case of ADHD. So I was interested in everything, picked up every, you know, I think it actually helped me because it made me interested in all sorts of different subjects. And I wanted to pursue things and do all sorts of crafts and get my hands on lots of stuff. And my dad has a PhD in chemical engineering. So he was happy to facilitate all of my adventures. So we used to do all sorts of things. I remember we had all these light filters, and you would talk to me about like how light passes through different, you know, so some physics. And then we did, he found some copper sulfate, and we, you know, ran a current through it. So we did all sorts of crazy
stuff. Wow, that's fun.
Mm-hmm. So I was really, yeah, science was at the forefront when I was a child. And my mom's a computer scientist, so I got kind of both angles.
Decent. Okay, so you're just curious, and they just fed your curiosity. That's what so cool.
Mm-hmm.
We're lucky, Ali, because both my wife and I are science teachers, and our kids love like science. And we're also very lucky that we live on a farm in the middle of nowhere, so you can do a lot of like quasi dangerous experiments and not get noise complaints and or get arrested. So that's the other good thing about living in the middle of nowhere.
Oh, that's fun. Yeah.
Yeah. We blew up many a pumpkin at Halloween. It was, lots of fun there. So before we get into the scent detection stuff you're working on, could you just talk a little bit about the infant speech and the dog speech study research that you did, just as a little bit of a background there? 'Cause it's fascinating.
Sure. The first study we did was looking at infant speech perception and noise as it compares to canine speech perception in noise. And that study, I'll quickly summarize it because there's another study I really want to talk about. So the noise study demonstrated to us that dogs' auditory systems are, you know, more mature than infants' auditory systems. So dogs were able to understand and listen longer to their own name as compared to another dog's name in more intense levels of noise than infants are capable of. So that's the kind of basis of the noise study. And that's how we learned that the methodology works. So the methodology is called head turn preference procedure, which basically relies on the fact that infants will turn and look at things when they're interested in them and then will turn away when they're bored. And luckily, dogs do a very similar thing.
Oh, yeah.
So we're able to harness that and basically play audio, and dogs and infants will look at the source of the audio while they're interested. And then when they're bored, they'll turn away. And then we turn off the audio, which is also sort of a signal to them like, yeah, when you look away, it stops. So, you know, when you get bored of it, you can make it stop. And that allows us to gauge their interest and their desire to listen to different types of stimuli. So we can learn a lot and about their preferences and kind of tease things apart there. A study that we just put in to a journal was looking at dogs' ability to differentiate between languages. So staying on our bilingual topic here, we're always really interested in how infants are able to sort of separate words in from different languages. Because often when you're bilingual, you kind of mix your languages together. So how do infants know that one word belongs to one language and another word belongs to another language? And, you know, how do they tell when you're, you know, speaking French or when you're speaking English? So a lot of that research has focused on sort of two things. The first is the rhythm of the language, which is kind of like, you know, the syllabic flow. Like when you hear German or English, those languages sound different than French or Japanese because kind of the structure of the syllables and the rhythm of the language is different. The other difference is in the actual sounds of the language. So, of course, you know, French has a lot of like, you know, sound that English doesn't have that makes it, you know, kind of obvious when you're a non-French speaker saying French things, because it's really hard to say that R that's in the back of the throat, or, you know,
you have to roll your R's.
And it's really hard to make those sounds when you're a non-native speaker. And that's one of the cues that infants can learn to differentiate between languages. And we were interested to see if dogs were able to pick up on these cues to help them differentiate between languages, especially because we know in infants that the sound cue, so hearing those sound differences, the R's and the vowels, that's harder for them than the rhythm. So they're able to differentiate between different rhythms of language at about 5 to 6 months. And then they're able to do sounds around 12 to 13 months. So we wanted to see, you know, with dogs' experience, how they would tackle, you know, two different languages. So what we did is we took a set of dogs that heard English in the home, English hearing dogs, and then a set of dogs that heard Spanish in the home. So some of these dogs were raised in Spanish speaking households, and some of them were actually adoptees from Puerto Rico, because this was pretty recently after the hurricane in Puerto Rico.
Okay.
So we had a bunch of refugee dogs sort of that were flown up into DC and were adopted. So those dogs spent somewhere around 2 to 3 years as street dogs in Puerto Rico and then were flown up. So we said, sure, that probably counts as a Spanish hearing dog. We did group them in a separate group, but turns out their behavior is not much different than the Spanish hearing dog. Spoiler. Then what we did is we played both of these groups, Spanish speech and English speech. So they're fairy tales. We had a speaker who had a native accent in both Spanish and English, and we had her read The Three Little Pigs in Spanish and in English. And we played it for the dogs. And we said, okay, we'll see what you listen longer to. And if they listen longer to one than the other, we, you know, with infants and with dogs, that suggests a differentiation, the idea that I prefer or I listen longer to this than that, so I know that this is different than that.
Okay.
So what we find is that first, yes, the dogs are able to differentiate between the two languages, but more importantly, the dogs who heard English at home preferred to listen to Spanish.
Oh, really?
Who heard Spanish at home preferred to listen to English. Yep.
Whoa. Do you have any idea why?
Yeah, it's just a pure novelty preference.
They're like, cool, what's going on?
And what's interesting as a comparison is that we know that infants actually, when presented with languages around, you know, the 4 to 5 months of age, they show a familiarity preference. They'd rather listen to the language that their parents speak at home, which makes perfect sense. They're trying to learn it.
Yeah.
They're trying to understand it. Dogs are just like, hey, I don't need to learn this. So this thing is cool. Like, that's fun and new, you know? So the result makes sense, but it's also very interesting because it shows that, you know, they're listening and processing the sounds in their environment.
Oh my goodness. You know, I think I might be kind of a dog because whenever I'm like wandering around one of our schools, if I ever am free enough and I hear one of the French teachers talking and they're animated because stereotypically, the more Francophone you are, the more you use your hands when you speak. I'm listening to them the French teachers talking, you know, they're instructing French immersion in science or something. And I just get enthralled listening to I don't know what they're talking about, but it's so exciting. So I think I maybe had a past life as a dog. That is hilarious. I love that. So what made you choose the Three Little Pigs?
Oh, just out of amusement.
Oh, okay.
It sounded good in Spanish. Honestly, we had a couple of choices, but we wanted stories that had words that we thought that the dogs wouldn't hear often
Huff
in everyday life.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, they're not going to hear them tremendously often, right? But like a lot of the other fairy tales involved some things that the dogs, you know, words that the dogs might encounter. We tried really hard to, you know, of course, function words like and of and the are going to, they're going to hear those. But we tried to eliminate any sort of cool content words like treat or food. otherwise, of course, the dog's going to be like, hey, that's fun. So yeah, the result is really interesting. I'm really excited about it. And sort of the further steps, because as I mentioned before, that babies can use these kinds of two different cues. This is just the baseline experiment because English and Spanish actually differ both in rhythm and in sound. So our subsequent experiments that we're working on now involve using languages that have the same rhythm and different sounds, and then have the same sounds but different rhythm.
Got you. And that involves a whole another area of language rather than, yeah, the whole science of, I forget what it is. The tempo and stochastic. I think we talked about it on the podcast. I was trying to remember. You had given me a good definition of what was going on there. But I don't know.
But it's fun. So like for example, we can use, for different sounds, the same rhythm. I'm hoping to use Danish and English because Danish has a lot of different vowels than English. And I think that'll be an interesting language pair. And then for same sounds, but different rhythm, we can use English and Singaporean English because there are native speakers of English in Singapore who speak English, but the English has the same rhythm as Chinese, which is really interesting. So,
okay.
Fun language pairs.
Got you. Mm-hmm. Chris, it's kind of like French Canadian French and then French French because there's always a big war about who's speaking it right, at least in Canada. And then French Canadian French, and then people from France French, they are like, you guys are not speaking it correctly, something like that. There's always a big fight at our school sometimes when we have French kids come on exchange, and then they have a little war of words with all of the Canadian French kids, just because there's a little bit difference.
Yeah, the sounds are different.
Yeah, it's
and
different.
Kids can totally, there are other experiments showing kids can differentiate between accents. So yeah, they know.
They know,
they
yeah.
Absolutely know.
I love it. That's so cool. Mm-hmm. So let's get into what you're studying, what you're looking at now with olfactory or scent detection. This is exciting because when we last left our conversation, you were moving into just the idea of dogs detecting COVID. I believe we tweeted out something like send articles of clothing to your lab or something like that. Is that true? I think
that
so.
Correct.
Yeah. You needed like people's shirts or something.
Shirts.
Yeah.
I did. So at the time we were in a big collection process where I was, tweeting a bunch and contacting a bunch of people to send us t-shirts. So what we would do, we would send you a t-shirt after you filled out a screening form. And you would send back your t-shirt basically with a picture of your COVID results
right.
So that we'd have kind of the sweat smell on your shirt and then whether or not you were positive. So we actually got about like 500 shirts from all across the country. It was incredible. The response was incredible. And I cannot stress how important that is for the kind of work that we're doing. Yeah. Because for detection work, if you want a dog to find COVID in any person, then the samples you train them on have to be representative. They have to be representative of every person as closely as we can possibly mimic it, right? So the more samples you have, the better. So you can train dogs to really find that signature odor and not to be distracted by any other potential odors that may be, you know, of a person, of which there are many.
Right. So if I just sent you like 100 pairs of my shirts, the dogs would just know like a 6'3" white Canadian guy sweat. Basically,
it'd be a Jason detector. It would just be a one person detector.
They'd be like, I think it smells a little bit like maple syrup in there too. So
exactly. So like, and that's of course, unfortunately been done before where, you know, you only use, shirts from, people who identify as male, and then you just found, you know, you have men detectors instead of, because dogs would much prefer to use the easiest possible cue to differentiate, yes. Right? Because we're just saying, what's different is really the question that we're asking them. Here are right. two things, what's different? And we would also pick the easiest possible option. We're not going to, you know, delve into the nitty gritty if there's like an obvious difference, like these two are different colors. Like, oh, that's not what I meant for you to learn. Well,
so the question I have for you is, what did all of that find out? I kind of know where it went, but I'd be curious about what the research that you gathered found.
Absolutely. So this paper is almost ready to submit. We've been preparing it with a lab in Florida
who has
been doing GCMS, gas chromatography, mass spectrometry. So some fancy chemistry on the shirts to figure out all the different molecules in them.
Yep.
So basically I'll describe a little bit of what we did with the method. So we got all these shirts and we cut them up into pieces, and we, as a lab, we were sharing them with a bunch of other labs. So we were the sleeve lab. So we got all the sleeves of the shirts. The fronts and backs went to various other labs to do other tests with the shirts. So we had these sleeves, we put them in mason jars, so you know, pretty simple storage actually. And then when we're ready, we
in mason jars.
Oh yeah,
okay,
jars. We just put them in mason jars.
Okay,
we wanted this process to be very simple. A lot of what we do is trying to make sure that the methodology is something that could in theory be replicated by someone who's trying to train dogs. Gotcha.
I'm just concerned for some millennials, they won't have enough mason jars for their wedding. That's all. So.
it has really put me off of drinking out of mason jars, given the number of things that I've seen in them.
Okay.
In my lab. So we start off with, we had a set of five wonderful dogs. Mm-hmm. Some of them were owned by the Working Dog Center. All of our dogs go home with fosters, by the way, in the afternoon. So it's kind of like school. Mm-hmm. So they come into school and they work on this COVID project. And then some of the dogs were owned by staff members. So they're not official dogs owned by the center, but you know, they're owned by dog trainers. So they're, you know, they do pretty well. And all of them had been trained on a scent wheel, which is a device that we use where it has sort of eight arms, like a bit of an octopus. The dog walks around and sniffs each end of this octopus. And then once they find the positive odor, the dog performs a trained final behavior. So you may have seen explosives dogs perform a sit or a down when mm-hmm. they see an explosive. In medical detection, we prefer a stand and stare alert for a few reasons. We found it to be more accurate when a dog stands and stares with their nose on the odor, because it allows them to continually intake the odor while they're telling us it's correct. When you sit, their nose backs away from the odor. So it's kind of like they have to make a decision and then they move their nose away from the odor. So I like it, you know, we like that they're able to continually intake that odor while they're making a decision. Also, it allows us to kind of get this really interesting hesitate data where the dogs pause for a moment, don't perform their full train final alert. And that tells us like, oh, this sample, there's something interesting about it that maybe Toby thinks is cool, but Toby knows like it's not correct, but maybe we need to send it to the GCMS people to see like if there's something up with the sample.
Oh, that's so cute. The dogs are like, something's up here.
Oh, it's very fun when you see the dogs being like, this is close. not quite. So these five dogs were trained over a period of about 3 months on all of these odors. So they in order to reach our benchmark, which was an 80% accuracy, which 80% sensitivity, which means they, when presented with a positive odor, they would alert on it 80% of the time, and 80% specificity, which means when they're presented with a negative odor, they pass it 80% of the time. Unfortunately, those words sound really close to one another, so it took me a long time to get them straight, but those are important words in the field of detection. So it took them about 300 samples to get to that benchmark. And then we ran them on a series of double blind tests on the scent wheel, where the handler does not know where the sample is located and the researcher leaves the room. So anyone who knows where the sample is completely leaves the room, and we just let the dog go into the wheel room and search. And we record their behavior. And for this particular test, we actually didn't reward the dog if they perform their train final behavior on the correct sample, because we wanted to see what their opinions were about all of the samples on the wheel. So, and this kind of method of not rewarding at the correct answer is also important for dogs that will need to screen unknown samples. So I can't reward an unknown sample because I don't know if it's positive or not, and I don't want to sort of provide an exemplar for the dog that's incorrect. So we try and train our dogs with what we call intermittent reward, which means the dogs are aware that, you know, maybe like 80% of the time they'll get a treat for hitting on the correct answer, but 20% of the time they won't, and they'll have to do another one and then they'll get the treat. And that's just helpful for these like unknown cases. So on the wheel, the dogs were not rewarded for alerting on the correct sample, but we got their opinions on all the samples. And then after the test, the dogs got all the rewards and all the cookies and all the love.
Oh.
So we did five tests with them.
Okay. Keep going. I had a question, but I think you're going there. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh yeah. So we did five tests with them, and what we found, so accumulating the results together, the dogs separating the results is probably the most important thing to do, because we had a sort of a tiered result system where three of the dogs clearly learned the odor correctly. So they had a sort of an average of 83 to 85% hitting on the positives, so that's their sensitivity, and then somewhere in the 98% on their specificity. So they were passing all the negatives like champs. And they were hitting on most of the positives.
Wow.
Then there were two dogs who were having a bit of a harder time, and their accuracy was closer to about 50%. They were hitting on maybe 30% of the positives and passing all of the negatives. So
sounds like our at home test we have in Canada. Yeah, am I positive? I don't know. Let's do it seven times. I'm not sure.
Lesson in that not all dogs are great at this particular kind of work. It's why not all dogs are successful at being guide dogs, and not all dogs are successful at being search and rescue dogs. This is a very particular task where we present two extremely similar things. You know, it's kind of like that meme, like, what's the difference between these two pictures? Corporate wants you to know.
And yeah, then,
like,
Pam Beasley.
The Pam Beasley meme. It's that, except there is a very, very, very small difference, and you have to find it. Like, so two pictures, find the very, very tiny difference is what we're asking the dogs to do. So it can be frustrating, and some of the dogs get frustrated. Sometimes the frustration can fuel you and get you to the correct answer, and sometimes it's harder.
Just like people.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it's important to note when we're talking about our results that, you know, some of these dogs were super successful and some of them didn't do so well. And what's interesting is we then made an attempt to do sort of a transition to an on-person study.
Yeah, that was going to be my question. Like, this is all controlled in the lab, right? In vitro, was that called?
Yes, this is all in vitro.
Yes.
All shirts worn by people, but they're in glass jars. And the room
they're not on people.
Is, you know, quiet. Yeah, they're not on people. And what we did was we took those sleeves and we pinned them to people. I should note that sweat does not contain any COVID virus. So no dogs or humans were at risk for this. That's the good thing about using sweat, is that we don't sweat any viral particles. So we pinned the t-shirts to people and then had the dogs check a lineup. And we learned several important things from this. First, the dogs who are successful in vitro are probably the opposite of the dogs who would be successful in vivo. Because if you're thinking about the dogs who are successful in this sterile environment with nobody watching them, where they can just go and sniff the samples at their own pace, it's completely quiet and they can do their own work. That's how they work best. And now I'm like, look at all these people and it's loud and we're all in a room and you have to sniff this, you know, and I'm making you walk directly up to somebody. So they struggled a lot with that transition first, especially because they were not the ideal dogs for that kind of work. And the second point is that there's a vast difference between the odor on a t-shirt and the odor of a human being. Like we're pretty smelly as people. For dogs, like, they can find us from a great distance. You know, and we're heated. So we're like pumping out odor into the air. And the problem with sort of pinning a piece of shirt to somebody is that, you know, of course we only let people who test negative come to work, as, as most workplaces do. And if you're negative and we pin a positive shirt to you, your odor of being negative is kind of usurping the positive odor that we've pinned on you.
That'd be so confusing for the dog.
It was extremely confusing for the dog. Even when we sort of trained them to target the shirt, it was still like there's so much extra odor and there's so many extra things for them to think about. It was a really difficult task for them. So, you know, it prompted us to write a methodological paper that we're working on now, talking about the importance of training in the scenario that you intend to use the dogs in, and training with samples that are as close as possible to the actual scenario that you are going to be using the dogs in. And that counts for COVID dogs or for conservation dogs, for anything, because dogs are exquisitely sensitive to changes in context. And there have been many studies that have shown that, you know, dogs successful in one context, if you switch something in the environment, like changing to a different handler or moving to a different area that's a bit larger, will lower their accuracy. It's perhaps temporary, but it does lower their accuracy and would require additional training for them to acclimate.
Well, if we use a sports analogy, you could practice shooting a basketball all you want, but if you've never played against somebody guarding you, you're going to have a bit of a rough go trying to hit the shots.
100%. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, the scenario is entirely different. You feel different. And that's, you know, how the dogs did as well.
Have there been dogs that have, I thought I read something, or we did a story on the podcast about it. There were dogs that were trained for real life, like people who were testing positive at airports, or maybe I'm getting my wires crossed there.
No, you're correct. We reached out to them, but they were, because they're companies, they were not willing to share their training regimen with us, or
companies.
What they were training on, or, you know, yeah, it's kind of unfortunate because we'd love to know so that we can sort of put together our brains, because we know that what the like methodology that we used for training in vitro was really, really successful. Mm-hmm. So it would be, you know, useful to see if there is you know, some sort of singular best practice training methodology that we could put together. But nope, unsure what the company's methodology is. I do believe that some of them are using a synthetic COVID positive odor that was proprietary and made by a different company.
There you go.
Yeah, again, not sure about that either. They, we asked if they would send it to us, but they were unwilling to do so. So there's some, you know, it's hard working with companies sometimes. They're unwilling to share things, but as companies are wont to do. Unfortunately, it's hard to know. But of course, you know, there are dogs that screen very successfully for explosives at airports. But I do think that one of the hardest things to do is to screen people. There are some dogs that have been quite successful at detecting odors in sort of the, as people walk away, sort of the trailing odor of people. Mm-hmm. But that's, it's kind of the use of dogs in infectious disease surveillance is kind of a brand new field that is, you know, no best practices yet. We're just kind of feeling it out.
Yeah, it seems so new. Like, the science makes sense. The dog knows. We did a little... One of my science communication things I did today is I shot a little video about just how powerful the dog nose is. You know, like, they've got millions and millions of scent receptors to billions, depending on the dog breed. Plus, their olfactory sensors are 30 times bigger than ours, or the bulb that's on top of the nostril. So, like, the science makes sense that they can smell incredible things. It's just parsing out. They can smell it, but they just don't care. And you've got to train them to care, you know?
Exactly. And there's attentional aspects to it too. You know, attention is a big part of my previous research in in my old lab. And it's quite hard to train a dog to say, this is an odor that you need to focus on, an odor that means something that you should pay attention to. Because, you know, as humans and as animals, there's tons of stimuli in the environment at any given time. And we have to choose what to focus on selectively. And, you know, maybe if I really love chocolate, I'm like, yeah, I know chocolate. When there's chocolate around, I know. And we have to get dogs to the point where they're like, COVID is great. I want to find it because I get my toy.
Oh. Oh my goodness. Well, this is why I don't think we should look to cats for any kind of like COVID testing, because they would one time and they'd be done, or they would know. And they straight up wouldn't care. I know you have COVID. I'm not telling anybody. Screw you guys.
So I did. I actually participated in a cat cognitive study with one of my cats. That's actually a study that we do in our lab.
Okay.
Called the Impossible Task, and it's a study of drive, which is really important for working dogs. We want them to be persistent,
yes,
even in cases when they feel frustrated. So what the impossible box is it's a clear box that we, for a few trials, leave open and put a treat or a toy in there. And then we let the dog go. The dog knocks over the box, gets the treat or toy. Yay. Super exciting. Super fun. So we do that three times. Fourth time, we lock the box.
Oh, no.
So we put the treat or toy in. We lock the box. We say, okay, go for it. And then we count the number. We have video coding programs that we use to do this afterwards. But when we watch the video, we're counting the number of behaviors that the dog tries, so different strategies like barking at it, using their paws, using their mouth, pushing it around, whether they look to people for help, which is in a working dog, not a thing that we necessarily want, depending on the type of working dog. So for search and rescue dogs, for example, we really value that independence, so we'd prefer, you know, seeing them just tackle the problem themselves. And then we see if they keep going for it, because we give them 5 full minutes to try and open the box, which, if you've ever sat for 5
so long,
it's a very long time.
If I couldn't get into a bag of chips after 20 seconds, I would burn the house down. I'm just gonna tell you.
Yeah, and these dogs, incredibly, what you see is, you know, these working dogs are quite different than pet dogs, because most of them will spend the 5 full minutes screaming at the box and absolutely trying to destroy it, which is why we're currently on Impossible Box 3. literally, we have 3 iterations. I'll post pictures on my on my Twitter page after this. But yes, there's been three versions because there is a police dog who came and just absolutely grabbed this pretty hefty plastic container and just smashed it in his jaws and then walked away with the food that was in it.
Was it a Malinois? Like,
it was.
I knew it was a Malinois. Those dogs have no chill.
Oh, of course not. No, Malinois are just absolutely out there.
They're intense.
I love them.
Yeah, they're
so
awesome.
Intense, but just but like they're intense about everything. So they're also intense about loving you. They're like, I'm gonna body slam you because I love you so much.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, Impossible Box 3 actually features a recessed box so that the dogs can't get their mouth fully around it. We had it built. One of our former research assistants' father was a carpenter, and he literally constructed this box to make it working dog proof. So back to the cat part. I've done this task with my cats with a normal Tupperware, and she looked at it for about 5 seconds, and then was like, and then hit it with her paw one time, and then was like, no, and just walked away. And I looked at the experimenter. I was like, is that good? Is that fine? And she was like, yeah, that's what we pretty much expect. I'm like, oh. I generally expect 5 full minutes of engagement.
That's the best. I knew your story was going that way because I've talked to other researchers that work with cats, and that is the biggest issue in data analysis with cats is they just straight up do not repeat anything. They'll do it once and that's it. And you're like, well, okay, I guess that's all we got for the data set on this cat.
We
need more cats.
It didn't work. Why would I try it again?
Yeah. That's true. You know, like, are they lazy? Or are they just like straight up way smarter than us? I think they're pretty intelligent. So
I think I got 2 cats. I think they're pretty, they're pretty clever in my opinion. I think, well, one of them might be a little more clever than the other one. They send my Calico Kiri spends a good amount of time trying to break into the cabinets in my house, and there's nothing interesting in them. She just opens them, goes in, and then walks out. So you know, I'm like, oh well, you try so hard to get into those that you could have, in theory, tried to get into this box with actual food in it. So
I don't know.
Who knows what's going on in their brain?
Who knows, cats? So I have, just so we don't, I don't know how much time you have tonight, Doc.
I'm free.
You're free? Okay. Well, I have one more question before we open up the floor to our community who would like to ask questions of you, of your research. And that's what you're working on right now, with, cancer and wasting disease in deer. I don't know what you're doing with that. When we last talked, it was like the start of this whole COVID stuff. So would you be able to break down what you're doing now with scent and these
Absolutely.
Diseases? Okay, cool.
So I'll briefly touch on the cancer because that just wrapped up. So we were doing a project working on sinonasal inverted papilloma, which is a benign tumor that has a high malignant conversion rate. So basically it's a tumor, but it can become cancer like very, very quickly, very aggressively, Oof. And often. So it's hard to detect because all of the biopsy procedures tend to not get enough tissue. So that's the kind of disease that the dogs are really good at helping out with, because they provide a non-invasive test by being able to smell blood plasma. So there's no biopsy or anything like that. So that's what we're working on with the doctors, is looking to see if there was an odor signature for this cancer or this pre-cancer. So we showed the dogs the SNP, sinonasal inverted papilloma SNP. So we showed them SNP positive and SNP negative blood sample. We trained them the same way we trained them on those COVID samples. And then we tested them on the blood plasma. And then interestingly, we also tested them on SNP samples from a different medium. So, nasal secretions. So they had never seen nasal secretions before, but they knew the SNP positive and SNP negative odor from the blood plasma. And what's really interesting is that the dogs not only learned an odor, so they were able to identify all the SNP positive samples, but they also transferred it to the nasal secretion. So they were able to find it there too. So
go dogs.
Yeah, go dogs. So what that tells us is that there is a signature present, and it can be found in both of these places. It's the same signature. And we can now partner with chemistry labs to try and identify that signature to hopefully create a non-invasive test for this disease.
Oh my goodness. Right. Cause they would, you could use gas chromatography to find the exact molecule the dogs were detecting.
Exactly.
Oh my goodness.
Mm-hmm. So it's extremely cool. And it's, I love the idea that there's, you know, the possibility for these non-invasive tests that can, you know, teach us a lot and can help us make machines that can mimic the dogs or, you know, use the dogs themselves. I prefer the idea in hospitals to use a machine because dogs have good days and bad days. Machines are machines. Mm-hmm. So, but the machines can learn from the dog's brilliance, and sort of be the tool in the hospital.
Yeah. And I think where applicable, it might be nice to have a few dogs in hospitals for people too.
Oh, absolutely. Have therapy dogs all up in the hospital.
That's right.
And the biggest project that we're working on right now is about chronic wasting disease, which if you are a hunter or you live closer to the woods, you might be more familiar with. I was not familiar with it. It is a prion disease in deer. So it's actually like mad cow disease, but it's in deer. You will not get it from eating infected venison. Now. I cannot prove that in the future. We always say, you know, you can't get it from eating the infected venison at this time. We don't know how the disease mutates and it can always change, which is another great reason to work to curb the spread of this disease. Mm-hmm. So I'm in Pennsylvania. The disease has spread to many captive and wild white-tailed deer herds. White-tailed deer are crucial to the economy and also just they're a keystone species to the environment. So the disease is killing off vast amounts of these deer and it's incredibly infectious. So, and unfortunately the only test for it is when to examine lymph nodes and brain when the animal is dead, which is also how you find mad cow disease. There are some antemortem tests that they're working on, but none of them are accurate right now. And all of them require restraining the animal to get a tissue sample, which if you're a deer is, you're probably not going to want that. So it's just not pleasant for the person trying to take a sample or for the deer. So we partnered with PA Department of Agriculture, as well as Wildlife Futures, which is a Penn vet organization that works with wildlife preservation and conservation to answer a couple of questions. First, would it be viable to use the big question is, would it be viable to use conservation detection dogs to try and curb the spread of chronic wasting disease throughout the country? And then a couple of questions stemmed from there. First, the best way to do this would be for the dogs to sniff fecal matter because that's available and easy and it doesn't involve going near the deer. And that would be, you know, exceedingly more simple than any other method of surveillance. So the question became, well, can they tell the difference between CWD positive and CWD negative fecal matter? Because currently testing cannot do that. The only test is that lymph node and brain test. We trained, actually, this study was run exclusively with community science dogs. So people from Philly brought their dogs in for training at the center. We taught them how to use the scent wheel, and we trained them on this odor, which was CWD positive fecal matter. So what they did is Wildlife Futures was able to procure samples and then test the deer to make sure we know that certain samples are positive and certain samples are negative. And we trained the dogs on these samples on the wheel. And we've answered the first question. Yes, there is a very clear odor differentiation between the CWD positive and the CWD negative odor. Yay. So that's great. But as we know from the COVID study, that doesn't really mean anything about what they'll do out in the field or whether they'll actually be able to survey or do anything like that. So what we then did is we trained these citizen science dogs how to search fields for CWD positive fecal matter. So we took a period of 6 months, and we started from a lineup of samples outside. We had jars, and we put them between bricks. Goodness. And we had to be really careful because if CWD-positive fecal matter touches the ground, it binds with the soil, and it stays there for 20-plus years. So we used sealed jars. We had lids on that prevented anything from falling out. But of course, it's like you cannot break the jar. We did not break any, knock on wood.
Oh my goodness. You know, like, it's like you're walking around with something like a, you know, a mine or something like that. Don't drop it.
We did have a decontamination protocol, but it was extensive and I really didn't want to do it.
So I was going to ask what would happen if you did break one. Like, have to get a land rec crew in there to dig up all the dirt, maybe.
Well, we have lye.
The
current protocol involves soaking with lye, digging out that dirt. It was extensive protocol that I really, really didn't want to do and luckily did not have to. So the dogs were all trained on outside searching from complete scratch. These were, again, dogs that had never done this before.
Oh my goodness.
We actually brought them to a big field at the head of the center, Dr. Cynthia Otto's house. And she has a big, big field backyard, and we cordoned off areas, buried samples, and had them search for CWD in a pseudo-realistic setting, and they were really successful.
Wow. That's so cool.
And what that led to is we're actually currently training real CWD detection dogs to go out and do that kind of work. So it's in progress.
Is most of your, like, this is so cool, Doc. Are you excited with your job? Are there most days you're just like, you can't wait to get to work to figure out what the dogs are going to do? But because they're dogs, like their dogs have off days and maybe it can be frustrating. I just have a question about that.
Oh yeah. I mean, I love going to work first. I love a job where, I mean, a lot of my work is writing. So the dog care tends to fall to the interns and the research assistants. But you know, if I'm like really stuck or having kind of a bad day, I just go cuddle a puppy, which is not a thing that a lot of jobs offer. So I'm pretty pleased with it. But yeah, it is sometimes it's one of those, it's taught me a lot of lessons about trying to, you know, maintain my calm and my cool when things aren't going the way I want, because the dogs pick up on your emotions so easily. Mm. So, and I run a dog in one of the studies because I just like to, you know, it's useful for me to be involved and see how the process works. And so, you know, I run this big Malinois named Zozo. She's the pinned picture on my Twitter account. And so I run her in a couple of different studies. And sometimes she just, you know, Zozo has great days. And then sometimes Zozo's like, not today. And I have to just kind of, you know, take a deep breath and be like, okay, that's fine. Like, you know, like if she, you know, passes the hot odor that I know that she knows three times, like, okay, all right, sounds good. You know, I have to kind of keep it down, make sure I keep my cool. Otherwise, you know, they get increasingly frustrated as you get frustrated. So.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're just joining us, I have not been the greatest host because I've just been like totally fixated on what the doc has been talking about. I have Dr. Mallikarjun, who is a dog researcher with detection now with scents, different scent, olfactory. If you're just joining us, we had an interview section where we went over all of the amazing stuff that she's doing. Just wow, I'm in awe. Doc, would you be okay taking some questions from the community?
Yeah, I'd love that.
Okay, so we'll open up the floor to everybody on all the different social audio platforms. LinkedIn just has Indra. We have people popping in and out on Clubhouse. Right now, there's nobody. There was like 5 people 2 seconds ago. I don't know if there's anybody on Wisdom. It says there's a bunch of people, but if you're on Wisdom and you'd like to talk, just request. And then, of course, on Twitter Spaces, it's quite easy to see the people that are requesting. Chris, I think, is moving people up.
Yeah, I sure am. Okay. And I would like to give Paula a shout out because she told us about the search feature. And so I have been going through Dr. Amaritha's her feed by basically just searching keywords, and I've been able to put a bunch of awesome stuff that you are doing in the nest for people who are interested. I got one of your studies and your cute cats, like, just awesome. Thank you. So for our speakers, we have CC first and then Indra here on Twitter Spaces.
Hi, thanks so much for taking my question. Doc, I had a question about the dogs having bad days, like you were just mentioning to Jason's last question. So when you're actually taking dogs out to like a real life setting, like to study the look for the deer samples, for example, and they're having a bad day, how does that happen? Do you like bring more than one dog so that way you increase your chances of getting data every day, or do you just like call it off for the day and then bring the dog back when they're having a better day?
That's a great question. So there are a couple of different options. You know, when you notice, you know, this is just not a good day for your dog, you know, most of the time, if I was handling a dog and it's just not, it looks like it's just not going well, which is often, you know, preceded by some sort of environmental trigger. So for example, I know that Helen, one of our cancer detection dogs, if she goes into backup, which is kind of like, you know, babysitting because her permanent fosters are on vacation, her accuracy just plummets. Like, she does not like it when she has to go stay at someone else's house. So when that happens, and sometimes I'm able to predict those environmental triggers, and then I'm just like, all right, well, I won't run Helen at this time. But if it happens in the field, I usually, you know, it's not worth pushing most of the time. So it's often why they're, so for example, we're training, you know, a set of three dogs, there may be multiple dogs. But if there's only one dog, I would probably pack it up or at least give the dog a break, and try and reset them, try and get them hyped up, you know, play with the toy, try and give them the things that they like, but not, you know, push them too much.
That's great. Thanks so much for this really fascinating talk.
Of course. Thank you.
Thanks, Cece. Over to Indra.
Hey, Jason, Chris, and Dr. M. Hope you're all doing well tonight. I just found this fascinating. And for those people that know what I do, I just have to ask this question because I got a visual when you were talking, Dr. M, about how, I'm making dinner at the same time. That's the beep. I got a visual and a flashback to a movie, World War Z, how the zombies were able to smell people that had diseases and they weren't well, so they didn't want to attack those people. And it made me think about that. And the Brad Pitt character, obviously, he was the, you know, he was the one that had some sort of disease, so he could be the hero and everything else. But I just found this, my mind works like that, where I just suddenly flash to a movie. I just wanted to know from your perspective, have you ever watched movies and kind of got inspired by ideas? I mean, I know that it's possible, like with other science, you know, that pertains to planets and things, but there's so much creativity in movies. And just by what you were talking about, you have so much creativity. So I was just listening to that and I was just amazed.
Oh, yeah, we're big movie people in our lab. We are enormous Jurassic Park fans. And coincidentally, we are doing some, not dinosaur sort of archaeological stuff, but we are in the process of putting together a study looking at detection and verification of ancient pottery. So sort of art verification, which is very different from what we normally do and very exciting. But yeah, I love movies and TV shows and often very inspired by them.
Oh, that's amazing. Thank you so much. I hope I didn't take everybody off track, Jason and Chris, but thank you
so much,
Doctor. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Actually, it just reminded me, just something you just said, Ben, a quick add-on. There was a Sandra Bullock movie that we just saw, and it had Brad Pitt in it. Again, where she goes off and she's a romance writer, and the guy looks like Fabio, but he becomes a real person. And then her guy that's in the movie, well, I'm not going to give it too much away, but anyway, they go off on this amazing trek and they find all this stuff out, and you know, it's just like nature and the jungle, and it was just something that you said. But I love it how you love Jurassic Park, because those movies are fantastic. So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
There you go, Doc. I found it for you on my soundboard. Indra, that's I love talking to scientists about movies. So I'm glad you asked that question. Every time I have a scientist, I'm like, so what you study, you've probably seen something similar in a movie. Like, is it real or is it a bunch of BS? So Doc, just on Indra's comment, have you seen a movie where a dog is like sniffing something out and you're like, yeah, that's pretty far-fetched what's happening there? Is there a movie that comes to mind with that?
Ooh, that doesn't come to mind, but what does come to mind is Arrival, which actually is pretty good. the linguistics movie. I call it the linguistics movie, but it is obviously a movie about things other than linguistics. But
the hepapods or whatever.
Linguists like Arrival. It's done well. So that's what pops into my head. In terms of, I mean, mostly it's in TV shows. Like, I watch Law and Order all the time, and I'm like, you know, like with the various dog handlers that find cadavers. So actually, those ones they're never bad, you know, because watching a dog do a train final alert at a thing could look like functionally anything, you know. So yeah. Like, usually it's like, yeah, okay, sure, some guy walks dog. Dog finds thing, dog sits. Sure, that could happen. But, you know, never something so prolonged where I'm like, oh, they'd never search like that or something.
One, it's a Canadian show. Mm-hmm. Chris, you know, recognize this?
The Littlest Hobo.
Yeah. There's a voice that keeps on calling me. Oh my! I'm gonna start crying, Doc.
Me too. I actually am crying. It's The Littlest Hobo.
There was a show that was on. When was The Littlest Hobo on Canadian TV, Chris? The 90s, early 90s.
No, Jason. No,
80s.
76. Yeah.
Early. Okay. Anyways, it was
The Littlest Hobo.
The Littlest Hobo was this German Shepherd, and the Littlest Hobo went from small town Canada, like random little tiny town to little tiny town, and like changed people's lives, like rescued Timmy who fell down a well, or you know, Farmer Joe was stuck under a combine or something like that. So you know, somebody fell into a river and the Littlest Hobo would save them. I never questioned. I just thought dogs were superheroes after watching The Littlest Hobo. Anyways, if you're a Canadian, this theme just gets ya. Down the road, it just gets you right now.
Every stop I make a new friend. Can't stay for long, just turn around and I'm gone again.
There you go. So any of the Canadians listening, you're probably got tears in your eyes like Chris and I. So Indra, thanks for that question. It brought a good conversation forward about dogs and movies. Doc, do you have a favorite movie dog?
Oh, that's a good question. let me think. Of course, the moment you ask it, I immediately blank on every movie dog. But
that's okay if you're on the spot. I'm sorry.
No, no worries. I'm just like trying to think about something different connection I can make with these dogs. I mean, what I will say is that I spent a lot of my childhood and a lot of, you know, watching these movies and reading all the books about dogs because I did not have one.
Okay.
And I did not, my parents didn't let me have one. They were, you know, in India, it's not as common to have dogs, and they were a little worried about, you know, the process and how we would take care of this dog. But I am about to do a long-term foster for one of the detection dogs who's coming in. So very excited about that. Pictures of him will be posted once he arrives. It'll be my very first dog. So.
Aw. Mm-hmm. Adorable. Chris, do you have a favorite movie dog?
Well, we just watched Oddball.
Oh, yeah. Oddball.
That was super cute. Yeah, and the littlest hobo is definitely top 10. And what other?
I have a special.
The Lady and the Tramp?
No.
And the 101 Dalmatians?
No, I do not like the old Disney movies.
What other dog movies are there?
I like Doug from Up. Hello. I was hiding under your stairs because I loved you.
Yeah.
Like that. I love Doug from Up.
I like the dog.
Hello there.
I will say that. So I had Wishbone, obviously.
So I had
a long Jack Russell Terrier thing because of the dog from Frasier and Wishbone.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that dog was very popular on Frasier.
Mm-hmm.
Indra, you're still up here. Do you have a favorite dog, a movie dog?
I have a not-so-favorite movie dog, Kosho.
Oh.
I'm a little bit traumatized.
See, the irony is that Cujo a St. Bernard? I think he's a St. Bernard. And that is
Which is hilarious.
Yeah, because St. Bernards are just giant sucks. Like, they're just dopey, yeah. Giant, goofy, clumsy.
Too lazy to come after you.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have that time.
Now, if a Chihuahua got rabies, it would go right through the wall at you. Guaranteed.
Oh, 100%. That dog would be in your vent. Like,
Cece, you're still up here. Do you have a favorite movie dog before we go to the next request?
I think probably either Doug or the dog, the main dog from Secret Life of Pets.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. But Doug from Up is a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Sarah has requested, so I'll bring Sarah up. Hi, Sarah. We're just talking with Dr. Mallikarjun. She's worked with, I don't know how long you were here for the space, but do you need a recap or are you good with your question?
I just joined. How long has the space been going on?
About an hour.
Oh, gosh. Hold on a second. Let me put my headphone in. Hold on. Mm-hmm. Oh, I wish maybe a brief recap.
We have Dr. Mallikarjun, who is a dog researcher that is part of a team that trained dogs to detect COVID in samples and now is working with dogs to detect cancer and also wasting disease in deer.
Couple of questions that brings up. In what usage is the COVID dogs being used for to sniff COVID? What would be their practical use?
Great question. For our dogs, none. Because we are doing proof of concept.
In theory, then, what would be their practical use?
So the field of biomedical detection for infectious disease is super brand new. So there is no real benchmark or practice for what we kind of expect dogs to do in the field. I think that the most liberal or the most fantastic idea that people think of is kind of like a dog screening a lineup or a dog screening a crowd that's going into a basketball game or something like that. That's extremely hard for a number of reasons involving both odor and also training a dog mechanically to do so. There are other sort of intermediary steps. For example, dogs can screen odor from people's palms. So you could pull people from line and screen palms, or you could have dogs screen people one by one as they step through a lineup. These are all options that people have proposed that haven't really been quite implemented yet in large form. But it requires a very specific dog, very specific training. What we do know is that they can, in theory, learn the odor, differentiate it, and generalize it to a vast population, vast diverse population. But it's a great question as to whether or not this is the most effective way of doing this.
It might not be effective, but, you know, I think I'd rather be sniffed by a dog than have to take a COVID test.
If I got off a plane and they're like, you got to go get tested. I'm like, dang, yeah. By a dog. Okay.
Okay. I'd be like, bring on the hounds. Because the COVID tests are so horrible. I do know, and I think I mentioned this in one of your previous spaces, dogs that have sniffed out cancer. My mother had breast cancer, and her dog kept sniffing. She had a beagle, and beagles have really good noses. They're just not trainable. But her beagle kept sniffing in her armpit and near her left breast. And she did it so much and so often, and it was so bothersome that my dad jokingly said, maybe you should go get checked out. And she was stage 3. No lump, nothing detectable. And my mom often credits her life being saved to her dog, who could smell that something was wrong.
Absolutely. Dogs are just so incredible at detecting these odor changes. And it's awesome that your dog sort of did a pseudo indication on it just to say, hey, like, this is different. Right. Also highly recommend that everyone Google the Beagle Brigade, which is a trained group of beagles that does agricultural detection in airports. Very cute. So
the Beagle Brigade. I love it.
Oh yeah. I've heard of them too. And you should Google them because they're really cute. Beagles have such great noses, but they are so hard to train because they will follow their nose. but her dog recognized a different scent. Mm-hmm. And even when she was going through treatment, my mom decided that she was like, I know that the cancer went away when my dog stopped sniffing me, where she could no longer detect it. And turned out when she went for her final lab work, it was gone. Awesome. But, you know, it's not like the dog was some brilliant cancer sniffing dog. She just recognized my mother's scent and that something had changed.
I mean, that's an impressive task in and of itself, right? The differentiation of a familiar odor from an unfamiliar odor in this mess of odor sphere, odor picture that all the dogs are getting is really hard, and dogs are really great at doing it.
They are. How do you guys train them? Is it, I hope it's reward based. You sound like a nice lady, so I doubt you're like giving electric shock therapy to dogs. Is it reward based?
We use positive training. So all of our dogs are rewarded and shaped with clickers and treats and toys. That's the most reliable way to build a long-term behavior.
Positive, it works with humans too. I've been training my husband for years. The click and treats really help. He's almost got taken out the garbage mastered.
Oh, man. I might move a little faster with some of my household chores if Chris shocked me though.
Well, that's our next step. I don't want to be too terribly cruel, but we are going to move to the shock collar next.
Yeah, no worries. We use positive reinforcement training in the wheel. It's, you know, we're asking the dog to do something incredibly difficult. So we use basically levels of treats. So if the dog goes around the wheel once and doesn't get the answer correct, but then goes around the second time and gets the answer correct, they get sort of the second tier treats. It's like, oh, you did a great job. Here's like kibble, which is a thing you like, but isn't the number one thing. And if you go around and get it correct and you get the number one thing, then you get the big party and the thing that you really like. You're like, oh man, I should really get it the first time.
And then one more quick question, if you don't mind, Jason and Chris. And,
nope.
What's their accuracy on detecting whatever it is that you're detecting, COVID, cancer? Are they pretty accurate?
It ranges. It ranges both between dogs, which we talked about a little bit earlier with the COVID dogs. So there are some, the COVID dogs kind of split into two groups. One that was in sort of the 80% sensitivity, so hitting correctly on 80% of the positive samples and then passing almost all of the negative samples correctly. And then there were a set of dogs that did not have any idea what was happening. they met benchmark, which is interesting, right? So all of these dogs met a benchmark during training. But once we brought on the double-blind test, sort of there's an environmental shift. We often talk about how to try and minimize that environmental shift from training to test as much as possible. Because during test, everyone's a little bit more tense and there are more people in the room and you know, people leave the room now. So we try and mimic that more often now during training to try and help the dogs out. But the really environmentally sensitive dogs are like, why is everyone leaving? What's happening? What's going on? And then they don't perform as well. So the answer is it really depends. Dogs can reach extremely high accuracy levels if you have the right dog and they are trained correctly. But we have, you know, we learned a lot from the dogs that have not been as accurate, which is really good to know, right? Like, so when we end up making mistakes, we're like, okay, so now we've learned something about the training process.
Well, thank you. It sounds like you all do good work.
Thank you.
Great question, Sarah. I know in one of the studies we broke down on the Science Podcast, with certain types of cancer, dogs are up in the 90s, like high 90s for detection of those cancers, which is just, it blows my mind away that they can smell that. But they're just built different, I guess. They're just so good.
I'd rather have a dog sniff my breast than have a mammogram. So I am for dog sniffing science.
Yeah, the non-invasiveness of the test is, or the minimal invasiveness is kind of a, you know, especially for things like the nasal cancer, like it's not pleasant to get a nasal biopsy. And then also they might not, and because it's not pleasant, they often don't get enough tissue for it. So then you get a false negative because they didn't reach the part with the cancer. But if it's in the blood plasma, you know, giving blood is relatively minimally invasive. So that's an easier way, an easier method of getting that done. So hopefully, you know, we use blood plasma for a lot of our cancer screenings. And we're hoping to do a study soon, kind of looking at similarities between a bunch of different cancers to try and see if there's, you know, something similar molecularly that's going on between, you know, pancreatic and ovarian and this nasal cancer, see if there's a similar odor.
Just a little side funny here for you. Like, Jason, would you rather have Bunsen and Beaker give your butt a quick sniff or have a colonoscopy?
Well, I mean, it's all about the invasive testing. And also, I mean, some people literally don't go get screened because it's so uncomfortable,
exactly,
shameful,
it.
Whatever they shouldn't feel shamed about it, but yeah, the less invasive, the better. And that's such a good point, Doc. Yeah. Same thing, Sarah. That's good questions you had too. Doc, do you have time for one more question? We have Paula.
I do.
You do? Oh, thank you so much. You know that you're being so gracious with your time. I so appreciate you.
Of course.
Yeah.
It's fun.
Thank you. I am smiling from ear to ear. We're bringing Paul up, and then do you have time for one more after that? We have just another.
Yeah, I certainly do.
Okay. Okay. All right. I've got time. I've got time tonight. So we'll go to Paula and then Dr. Nancy Von Meyer. Paula, hi.
Hi. Hi. How's everybody doing? Hi, Dr. M. This is so fascinating. I just have a real quick question. Is there any breed of dog that have better noses than others? Like, you know, would the hounds be better because they're made for, you know, sniffing out things? Like, you know, I'm just wondering if there's a certain breed of dog, would you really see a Chihuahua sniffing out COVID, or would like a bloodhound or a hound dog or you know, some bigger dog have a better nose for that?
So I love this question specifically because we have a wonderful community science dog who is a multi-poo, who is one of the most incredible detection dogs that I've ever seen on the wheel. Just an incredible dog. It's many studies have examined this, and really the sort of underlying mechanism that dogs are working with. There are some differences in numbers of olfactory reception and differences in the length of their nose, but fundamentally, the dogs don't seem to show a lot of difference in their ability to smell and differentiate between odors. The real difference comes in the trainability and their desire to work and task. So we harness a lot of the sort of natural behaviors of retrievers and shepherds for the tasking that we ask for. There is a great study out there that I can't remember who ran it, but they trained a bunch of pugs to do detection work. And they did great because they tend to do really well. It's just a motivational factor. You know, if as long as you're food motivated enough and you're a little bit okay with being wrong, it generally works out. So great question.
Oh, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks, Paula. Nancy, your turn.
Hey, thanks, Jason, Chris. Hey, Doc, I had just a quick question. Can you describe a little bit more about the Penn Vet Working Dog Center? I've been reading some of your posts and it looks like a fascinating place. Is there a
yes,
summary of what that place is? It looks interesting.
Yes. So the Penn Vet Working Dog Center was formed after 9/11 because our founder, Dr. Cynthia Otto, was a vet who worked at 9/11 with a lot of the dogs from 9/11. And she ran a longitudinal study looking at how being on the rubble at 9/11 affected these dogs in terms of their health and longevity. And what's really great is we actually see that there's no difference really between the health of those dogs and the health of control search and rescue dogs. You know, helping out in these disasters, even though they're you know, horrible and difficult places is not causing long-term damage to these dogs. excuse me. So what the center does now, it's a really wonderful, unique place that is a nonprofit associated with the University of Pennsylvania Veterinary School of Medicine. Dr. Otto is a professor at the veterinary school and also is the director of the center. So we both have a training side and a research side, but of course, research is sort of pervasive throughout our entire center and is kind of the founding principle of the center. But the training side actively trains search and rescue dogs, police dogs, detection dogs of different types like arson detection dogs, drug detection dogs. So dog trainers take the dogs out and do curriculum with them every day and work with them from 8 weeks where breeders donate dogs to us. And we also occasionally breed and raise our own litters. So it's a wonderful, really interesting place that's full of just the best people. And I love working there, and we're always constantly learning new things.
Oh, thank you. It sounds like a fascinating place. It must be like one of a kind, right? I mean,
it is the only place that kind of functions like we do with such a strong research base. There are a lot of places that train search and rescue dogs and other kinds of detection dogs, but we really try and ground everything we do in the literature. And we have a big research program, not only just with the studies I've talked about, but we also take data every time the dogs go out in the rubble pile or do any of the various training activities so that we can see their progress. And it helps us predict with puppies, you know, kind of we can detect problems before they arise, and we can maybe even hopefully in the future predict what career they go into.
Oh wow,
that's so
career
cool.
Training for dogs. That's great, thank you.
It's like you're almost career counselors.
Oh absolutely, yeah, we call it, we always talk about it like it's a college. You know, the dog pick their major, like they start off, you know, we do them,
they're little undergrads, they don't know what they are doing with their life.
They don't know what they're doing, and then, you know, they show aptitude for a specific thing and then they get to pick their major.
I love it. Well, I tell you, if I was ever lost, I would want to be a moose leg, because Bunsen would find me in literally 5 seconds flat. In a snowstorm beneath a snowbank with rocks on top of me, he would find me, but only if I was a moose leg. I don't know what it's all that smell coming off of it. Nancy, thank you for the great question. I think we'll wrap stuff up. The doc has been with us for almost an hour and a half. That's a lot of time. Thank you so much for being our guest tonight, Dr. Mallikarjun.
Absolutely.
We would love to, anytime that you have something that you would like augmented, Doc, like if some of your new research comes out, just let us know. I'm sure everybody who's listening tonight would love to know more as it as it comes available. I know you got some stuff cooking in a journal or submitted to a journal, and definitely will help augment that when the time comes.
That's wonderful. Thank you. Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. So we'll just wrap stuff up. And then, so we'll got some wrap up music. It's what we do. Thanks again to Dr. Mallikarjun, our guest tonight, who talked dogs, detecting COVID and cancer, wasting disease, training. Oh, it was so good. For giving your time up for us tonight. Thank you to all of the speakers who came up to ask questions, and to all of our listeners who were here when you could be anywhere else in the world. Chris, also thanks for being such a great co-host and putting all those stuff in the nest there. That's awesome. Thank you. We have two more spaces this week. We have a special Pet Chat space on Thursday at 8 o'clock Eastern. We have Shannon from Truly Force Free Training. So she runs a dog training school. Amazing. She has a podcast called Backyard Pet Chat. And her whole thing is taking the force out of training dogs and using positive reinforcement. So just like what you were talking about, Doc, with the dogs you train. We're going to talk about puppy training and then take your questions. That's Thursday. And as always, Saturday is Pet Chat. Pet Chat is at 6 p.m. Mountain, 8 p.m. Eastern. We have games. There's a prize. And then people just share their pet stories. So it's just a great gathering for community. That is what's happening with the rest of social audio this week. So that's about it. If you want to keep more in the know, sign up for our newsletter on our profile. One more time, Doc, thanks for being our guest tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, take care, everybody. Be well, and we'll hope to see you on Thursday, and maybe not on Thursday, but Saturday. Okay. All right. Bye, everybody.
There's still no meow.
Okay. I got another beaker bark. Look, okay. I can just keep pressing that.
Okay. You need the ginger meow.
I had that one for when you're sassy.
Out of town population me.